no one caught in sin remain inside the lie of inward shame. We fix our eyes upon the cross and run to Him who showed great love and bled for us. Freely You bled for us. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with Him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Beneath the weight of all our sin, You bow to none but heaven's will. No scheme,
and the title of the message is Resurrection, What's in it for me? And maybe to kind of go along with our myopic culture, what is really in it? And here Paul, and maybe the passage of scripture, it has more about the resurrection than any other. But when we talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, even as the girls were dancing, and of course those lyrics become more meaningful because they're literally being danced out before our eyes. It is the conquering of death. Death is the issue when it comes to resurrection. It's not just life or a celebration of life. It's a celebration of what happens after death and the conquering of death. And I love the story that a pastor tells about his little five-year-old son. And near their home, there was a cemetery. So as kids are inquisitive, there have been a lot of conversations every time they drove by there about what that is and why there's headstones and who's there and what happens there and so forth. So this little guy was pretty familiar with the cemetery, and they had paused at a stoplight right in front of it. And there was an area getting ready actually for a funeral. So there was a plot that was dug. There was earth, on the side that had come out of the ground and so forth. And the little boy noticed it, and he got very excited about that. And he said, "Look, Dad, one of them got away." And in a sense, that's what Easter is about. One of them got away in terms of Jesus' resurrection. I also happened to notice on a news site this morning, I don't know if you saw this story, it's quote gone viral. It's very interesting. It's a gal in Florida who named Emily Phillips, and she was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. The end of that was inevitable, and so she wrote her own obituary, and very interesting. And the headline is, "I was born, I blinked, and it was over." Now she goes on and talks about highlights of her life and everything from marching in the Mardi Gras parade in high school to a number of other events, and how important little things in life in retrospect become big. And there's some very interesting things she has to say about her life. But sometimes that's the way it seems like, at least if you're getting my age, it's like you're born, you blink, and it's over. But then what happens after that? And this is where the idea of an Easter message and resurrection is pertinent to everybody's reality, because we're all going to face the same thing. In a sense, we're all going, we've been born, we're going to blink, and it's death is inevitable. John MacArthur, in one of his books, says the following. There's a preacher of the old school, but he speaks as boldly as ever. He's not popular, though the world is his parish, and he travels every part of the globe and speaks in every language. He visits the poor, calls upon the rich, preaches the people of every religion and no religion, and the subject of his sermon is always the same. He's an eloquent preacher, often stirring feelings which no preacher could, and bringing tears to eyes that never weep. His arguments none are able to refute, nor is there any hearts that he has that have remained unmoved by the force of his appeals. He shatters life with his message. Most people hate him. Everyone fears him. His name, death. Every tombstone is his pulpit. Every newspaper prints his text. And someday, every one of you will be his sermon. That's kind of a stark reality, of course, to this idea of resurrection. To the person apart from Christ, that doesn't know Christ, that doesn't have the hope of heaven in a resurrected body, which we're going to talk about in a moment, the whole subject can be a little bit fearful, a little bit morbid. But again, to the person that's put their faith in Jesus Christ, this idea of resurrection actually is pretty exciting, and something that we celebrate pretty much every Sunday. That's why we come. Christ arose on a Sunday, and so we celebrate together on Sunday as a result. There is the prevailing thought and philosophy, at least among a lot of the what we call the millennials, to eat and drink and be merry, for tomorrow we die. Of course, that's not a new phrase of speech. That was first century Greek philosophy, at least for a group of people during that time. It's certainly made a comeback. In order to kind of get us into the text, I need to read a little bit, at least from the opening paragraph. So I'm reading from 1 Corinthians 3 to 8 here. Paul says, "For I delivered you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas," that's Peter, "then by the 12, the apostles. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present. But some have fallen asleep," that is, they've died. "And that he is seen by James," which would have been his half-brother, "then by all the apostles," and then Paul mentions himself. "And last of all, he was seen by me also, as one born out of due time," because, again, Paul, the persecutor of the church, who comes to faith in Christ there on his way to Damascus. That's a lot of eyewitnesses that is mentioned there. If you wanted to make your case in court, it would help to have 500 eyewitnesses to help make your case. And because of that verse, those words, because of the evidence of what we know about the death of Jesus Christ, as well as his resurrection, well, it's one of those things that we say is one of the more easily proved facts of all antiquity. And one of the men that tried to make a case against it was a man named Simon Greenleaf. Simon Greenleaf basically put Harvard Law School on the map. In 1883, he was named the Royal Professorship, In 1846, he succeeded Judge Joseph Story as the Dane Professor at Law. He wrote a three-volume work called A Treatise on the Law of Evidence. In other words, and still today, he set out what would be acceptable as evidence in a court of law. But he had one problem. He had these students at Harvard in his classes that were Christians that kept bothering him about the resurrection of Jesus Christ and concerned over his own salvation. He decided that pretty much he'd had enough of this, because it was year after year he had students in his class. So he took a sabbatical. He took a year off from Harvard, and as the person who wrote the textbook literally on what would be acceptable as evidence in a court of law, he set out to disprove the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because if you can disprove that, Christianity is all over. In fact, that's what Paul continues in his text to say: if Christ hasn't risen, we're still in our sins, we're to be more pitied than all men. So Simon Greenleaf, this one of the great attorneys of his day, set out to do that with a year to do the research. At the end of the year, he came back to Harvard as a Christian, because the evidence was so overwhelming for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. His response, he actually wrote this. Note that when the disciples of Jesus proclaimed the resurrection, they did so as eyewitnesses, and they did so while people were still alive who had contact with the events they spoke of. In 56 AD, Paul wrote that over 500 people had seen the risen Jesus, and that most of them were still alive. It passes the bounds of credibility that the early Christians could have manufactured such a tale and then preached it among those who might easily have refuted it simply by producing the body of Jesus. Again, it's not our aim of the message this morning to lay out evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, other than to stating there is tremendous evidence for it. It's what happens when you believe in it and you put your faith in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And again, what's in it for me in terms of me? And when I die, when I have that moment, I realize that I was born, I blinked, and it's all over, and it's all coming for all of us. In this text, Paul answers two questions. One is, how are the dead raised? And the second, what kind of body will we have? And he makes, first of all, two comparisons from nature, where he says, and again, this is kind of now in our main text of chapter 15, if you're following along, verse 35 to 41, he says, but someone will say, how are the dead raised, and with what body do they come? Foolish one, what you sow is not made alive unless it dies. And what you sow, you do not sow that the body shall be, but mere grain, perhaps wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he pleases, and to each seed its own body. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there was one kind of flesh of men, and another flesh of animals, another of fish, another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies, but the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, another glory of the stars, and one star differs from another star in glory. So a comparison in terms of the seed in the ground. You put the seed in the ground, and I'll show you a little 90-minute clip of what I'm talking about here in just a moment. But I picked this one for one reason, because I think you're familiar with the sunflower seed. I think I've eaten many thousands of them over my lifetime. It's pretty dead, isn't it? But now that it's dead, if it's placed in the ground, there's an incredible transformation that comes about. That's Paul's first comparison. Do we believe in the resurrection? He says, if you look around, there's a lot of them happening all around us all the time. Dead things that are going in the ground that actually come back to life. Jesus made the comparison of his own death before going to the cross. He said, unless a seed dies, it will remain only a single seed, but if it dies and goes in the ground, it can produce many seeds. And I think we've got this little clip ready for you. Anyway, I hope the visualization helps a little bit. I mean, if you think of the seed and then what becomes out of the seed, that's his first comparison out of nature in terms of a resurrected body. What will your body be like? What will mine be like in terms of the resurrection? Again, what you sow, you do not sow that body that shall be, but mere grain, perhaps wheat or some other grain, but God gives it a body as he pleases. So it's our resurrected bodies will be distinctively different than our bodies right now. If you're getting older, that's you say amen, hallelujah. We're kind of real happy about that. Again, this process is called germination. A seed has to germinate or die before life can come out of it, and that's the idea there. Our glorified bodies will be different from our earthly bodies, but there's a continuity. Again, it's out of the seed that the sunflower comes. It's out of this physical body that our new heavenly body, our resurrected body, will come. Very different, of course, but there's continuity. And with it, then, there's also an identity. Sometimes people are concerned about, will I recognize my grandmother or my grandfather when I see them and so forth with that glorified body? It's a good question because, remember, the disciples, after Jesus rose from the dead, at least two of them on the Emmaus Road walked with him 9 miles having a conversation with him and didn't realize who it was. Again, it was Jesus' resurrected body. He's walking along having a conversation. Luke records it in his gospel in Luke 24:30, where it says at the end when they recognized him, because again, this whole point of the illustration is continuity with identity. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with him, that he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road, and while he opened the scriptures to it? They did not immediately recognize him, but once he began to speak to them, once they had a little conversation, once they saw him break the bread, they recognized, in fact, that it was Jesus. It'll be the same for us, because our glorified bodies, our resurrected bodies, will be very different than ours now. There's a continuity in Paul's illustration, but there's something, an identity. Now, I'm going to go back in the archives of time. That's not my younger brother. That's actually me standing in the back there. And my son, who's 29, is probably 7 at that point. And I coached Pony League baseball for a number of years. My kids were pretty much half Kailua and half Waimanalo. And it doesn't happen a lot, but once in a while, I'll be at Safeway or Costco or somewhere, and some young man will come up to me and go, hey, coach. And it's just like, okay. Who is this, actually? I also went on and coached high school volleyball for 7 years, so this is a lot of kids that this could be standing in front of me. And I don't recognize him. You know, seeing those little guys as a 29-year-old, you know, you can see why you wouldn't necessarily recognize them 20 years later. But you know, as they begin to converse with me a little bit and kind of, hey, I play third base, and you know, they kind of give me a couple of particulars, all of a sudden, I can see that little face there. It's still there. And all of a sudden, it's like, there it is. Continuity with identity. That's the idea. Our resurrected bodies are being compared to a seed in the ground and the glory that comes from them. They'll be very different, but there'll still be that identity that goes with us. The second comparison, in terms of types of bodies, he begins to talk about heavenly bodies and earthly bodies. Men, animals, birds, fish have different kinds of bodies. The sun, the moon, and the stars, and so forth. And I don't know if you took the time to get up at 2 o'clock in the morning to watch the blood moon there on, I guess it was early Saturday morning. I just saw the pictures the next day. I figured that was good enough. But we'd seen one of the earlier ones. But amazing, again, the universe and so forth, and the differences. Again, amino acids are the building blocks of life, but each plant, each animal has a different type. They're all very individual, unique groupings and so forth. And so, too, again, that comparison, we will remain very unique and very individual in terms of our glorified bodies. The second half of verse 40, the glory of the celestial, the heavenly, the universe out there is one. The glory of the terrestrial is another. is another, talking about the splendor and just the variety of the universe and the stars and so forth. So how can God raise the dead? We might say in the same way that he can resurrect a seed into a plant. In the same way that he's created the diversity that's out there in the universe, what kind of body will we have? A resurrected body that has continuation from the earthly body. It has continuity, but will still be recognized by others. So that's his two comparisons from nature. And then he gives five contrasts to give clarity. Don't panic. I'll go through all five very quickly. Verse 42 to 49. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body, there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, and after the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust, us. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. The heavenly man, of course, is Jesus. But he first says, in terms of these contrasts, our new bodies will be permanent. The body is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. It's a contrast of durability. And again, very thankful for that, that these bodies that are wearing out are going to get the new model. There'll be continuation. There'll be identity. But once we have it, they won't begin to wear out again. You know, eternity is a very long time. So I'm glad that our resurrected bodies and what we receive are going to be permanent. And a body that doesn't wear out, that doesn't know disease, that doesn't know death, that doesn't know deterioration, that doesn't have to have two knee surgeries to keep you walking and so forth, doesn't have your back hurt when you get up in the morning. So it's all to see you get to, I'm making this very personal. I'm really looking forward to this time. But Revelation 21, John the Apostle writes about this as well. He says, God himself in heaven one day, God himself will be their God and be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, write, for these words are true and faithful. When we receive our resurrected body, it'll be permanent. It'll be eternal. Secondly, our new resurrected bodies will reach their full potential. That's in verse 43. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. So the second contrast has to do with value as well as potential. We could say that none of us ever reach our full potential. Sometimes we talk about kids and how bright they are, or gifted they are, and we hope they'll reach their full potential. And of course, if that doesn't happen, you know, it's like, well, you know, you think about what could have been and so forth. In terms of who we are and our identity, our ability to give God glory through our lives, that is to reflect who he really is. Sometimes as believers, we do that pretty well in terms of the love and the kindness that we show others. And other times we kind of drop the ball and we don't do it so very well. That won't be the case in heaven. We'll actually reach our full potential. This whole idea that we've been talking about in our study in Ephesians, that there is a war that goes on within us in terms of the old nature and a new nature that we're given when we come to faith in Christ, that war will end, and I'm very thankful for it. Won't it be awesome when every person never, ever has a selfish thought? It's just heaven's going to be amazing. We'll reach our full potential. First time I heard this word, I guess this is a baseball thing, but when I was a kid, there was no organized baseball until you were nine. Now, you know, Elijah started at four, and you know, David's going to start next year at three. You know, you know, and, but it was nine. They just had a little league in the town I grew up in, that was it. And I tried out, you know, and I got picked by a team. I went to that team the first week, and everybody else seemed to be real excited about the team that I was on. I didn't realize the ramifications of it until I got there, because I was nine, and I was now on a team with 11 and 12-year-olds. And so I was nine playing in the major leagues. And so I was a little concerned about that. And but I'd grown up with an older brother always playing with his friends, and I kind of had to play up to their ability, so a little bit of it was kind of normal. But I remember the first time they're teaching me to take infield practice, and the coach said something to the other coach. I didn't know what it meant. So when I got home that night, my dad said, well, how'd your first practice go? He says, well, one coach said to the other coach, I've got potential. Is that good? I didn't know what the word meant. My dad said, yeah, it's good. It means if you work hard, you can become a very good baseball player. But there's no guarantees, is there? And there's no guarantees that we'll ever fully be able to bring God glory truly all the time from our lives. And that's frustrating to us sometimes now. But it will be different in heaven. The third idea is our new bodies will be raised in power. Again, weakness in terms of physical strength, endurance, resistance to disease. Jesus said this. He said, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is, it's weak. It's weak right now. It's not what God intended. That will not be the case with our resurrected bodies. Fourthly, our new bodies will be perfectly suited for heaven. Verse 44, it's sown a natural body. It will be raised a spiritual body. This contrast has to do with the realm of existence. We have to be fit for heaven. If you were out on the ocean today and you wanted to go down into the water and go underneath the water, you would have to be fit for that. You would have to be equipped for that. You would need certain kind of fins. You need a weights. You would need a regulator and tanks and a mat. You'd need all these things to make you fit for that particular environment. And that's the idea. Our resurrected bodies will be made for heaven, natural to supernatural. The fifth thing is our new bodies will be like the post-resurrection body of Jesus. And this is probably maybe the one that helps us the most as we read about Jesus and his post-resurrection appearances, to know that we're going to be like him. That's in verse 47. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As was the man of dust, again, Adam, so also all those who are made of dust, that's the rest of us, and is the heavenly man, Jesus came and took on human flesh, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. So Adam had a natural body. It came first. It was of the dust of the earth. He was born of the earth. Jesus has a heavenly body. A spiritual body comes from the natural body. The spiritual body is from heaven. These are kind of a summation of these verses. But most importantly, we'll bear the image of the heavenly man. And that's exciting to know that what Jesus's body was like is what our post-resurrection bodies will be like as well. And I first want to say right away that I'm very thankful that he ate. I don't know if that matters to anybody else here, but I don't know if, you know, I'm just glad there'll be some eating and, you know, a little festivity going on in heaven, you know, when we get there. I'm pretty sure we're never going to have to be on a diet. As you get, getting older, it's like, can only eat certain things, not eat certain things. I think we'll be able to eat anything then, you know. But I like that scene of Jesus with the disciples on the Sea of Galilee, and they've been out fishing, and they're coming in. They catch anything. You know, you always love to hear that, you know, but not if you haven't caught anything. No, nothing, you know. And then they recognize his voice and get excited, come ashore, and he's already there. He's got coals going. He's got fish, and he's got some bread. He's making breakfast for them because they fished all night there on the Sea of Galilee. And they sit down and ate. And when we think of these appearances of Jesus, he appears in a locked upper room. And then he's able to, again, step in and out of what we call the space-time continuum. He's in an eternal state, as we will be. Very different, very glorious. Paul says, writing to the church at Philippi in chapter 3, he says, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly await for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, and here's the important part, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body. It will be like his. His resurrection body was not limited by time and space. John echoes the same thing in his first epistle. Beloved, now we are the children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, when Jesus comes back for us, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. So what will our resurrected bodies be like? Our new bodies will not wear out, not prone to sickness, disease, or death. Our new bodies will be perfect, and in them we'll realize the full potential of our lives and the ability to bring glory to God. No sin nature any longer. We'll be raised in power. Our new bodies will be perfectly suited for heaven, and our bodies will be like the post-resurrected body of Jesus Christ. You want one? So you can have one. You can have one this morning. Eternal life again. John says, this is eternal life, that you may know the true God. See, it's the resurrected body is awesome that we're going through. We look forward to it. It's really about knowing Jesus. Knowing the true God in Jesus Christ, whom you've sent, is he continues. Our third point is all believers will be changed. Is it true for everyone? This is true for everyone. Verse 50, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit corruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So all believers are changed when Christ returns for us. Again, he comes back to this question, how are the dead raised? And he answers it in verse 50. I declare to you, brothers, that flesh and blood can't inherit the kingdom of God, nor does perishable inherit the imperishable. The kingdom of God here is not in a universal sense. It's talking about heaven. And therefore, what will happen to Christians living at the time that Christ returns? And Paul uses the term mystery, something that was not known before, but is now known and understood. We will be caught up with the Lord instantaneously. Verse 52, in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. He mentions the same subject over in 1 Thessalonians in writing to the church there in chapter 4, where he says, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. All believers are changed when Christ returns. If you happen to still be living here on planet Earth, which I think would be the preferable way to go, then we're caught up instantaneously. Again, it's the dead in Christ. Again, Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with Christ. But in terms of the resurrected body that we're talking about, when Christ returned, those that are departed before us will receive the resurrected body, even as we've discussed and described. We who are left and alive will then be caught up again instantaneously to meet them in the air. To meet them means those people that you know and that you love, your family members, your friends, everybody that's preceded you. You will be with them in a moment, instantaneously, and you'll know every one of them. Again, we call this the rapture, papture passage, to be caught up and stuff. But Paul goes on and says, encourage one another with these words. This passage is meant to be an encouragement, not a theological debate. It happens when Christ returns. All believers are changed. And then secondly, all believers will be changed because death has been conquered, even as we sang about earlier, that's in verse 54. Then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? And of course, death is swallowed up in victory when Jesus dies on the cross for our sins. He conquers death at that point through his resurrection. The writer of Hebrews mentions Jesus through that being the captain or the pioneer of our faith. He's gone before us. He's conquered death. We just follow with him now. It's already been done. It's already been accomplished. And in fact, the last thing that Jesus says on the cross is, it is finished. Again, notice what Paul says in verse 56. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. How does the law strengthen sin? Well, it shows us our sin. You know, there's a lot of people that need to understand why they need to be forgiven. There's a lot that don't. You know, I've preached out at OCCC before. Don't have to convince anybody. they know they've sinned. They just want to know if they can be forgiven. You know, I've done a lot of messages in drug rehab places and River Life and places like that. Don't have to I don't need to go through the Ten Commandments. They know. They just want to know, can we be forgiven? Is there hope for us? There's a lot of other people, you know, they live pretty good and pretty moral lives. And sometimes they do need the law. They need to go through those Ten Commandments and think, you know, is there something I need to be forgiven of? Of course, Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, people say they love the Sermon on the Mount. That tells me they've never really read it because it kind of beats you up. You know, Jesus says, you know, if you've ever angered in your heart, it's as though you've killed someone. Well, that's kind of heavy. If you've ever lusted after, so it's as though you've actually done, you know, and he just goes on. Jesus says it's not just whether you can keep the Ten Commandments or the Big Five or the Dirty Dozen or whatever you happen to make up for yourself. It's if you've even ever thought it between the ears, it's though as though you've sinned. James says if you've broken the law in one point, you've broken of it in all. So Paul says that the law kind of comes and confronts us. It's a good thing. God's word is holy and true. It shows us our need of a Savior and our need to be forgiven. He says, but thanks be to God, verse 57, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Because Jesus did live that perfect sinless life and died on a cross so that we could be forgiven. There was no other way. And there was no other way because there's no other way for death to be conquered as well. Because again, death is the bully on the block that puts that fear into each and every one of us. Jesus Christ he's kind of taken the bully out, so we no longer have to fear death. Kind of began this message with this idea of death can be a subject that is, again, fearful for some people, but other people, it's not so much. It's this idea of being with the Lord and having that resurrected body for all eternity. When I was kind of making the move from elementary school to the intermediate school, junior high, different places call it differently, I'm like a lot of guys here, it's a big deal because basically you spent 6 years in an elementary school. There's been a few scuffles, there's been a few fights, and it's to establish a pecking order. Toughest guy right on down. And girls are going, I didn't know they did that. Yeah, they actually do that. And by the time you're in sixth grade, you know, it's pretty mellow, actually, because you kind of got this thing figured out by about third, fourth, and fifth grade. Yeah. Can I get an amen from any guys here? You know what I'm talking about. So when you go to junior high then, and you know, it's like now you've got several elementary schools, sixth graders that are feeding all together. What happens? The whole thing starts all over again, right? You know, that's why there's so much turmoil, you know, in junior high school and stuff. And I knew it would be starting all up over again. And then I made it worse. I was with a couple of my buddies, and we were skateboarding, and where we lived, it was flat. You know, so we looked for hills, and one of the hills that we had to skateboard down was the Sears loading dock. Because, you know, in my day, things closed on Sundays, so a loading dock was a hill. So we'd go skateboarding over there on Sundays. You know, skateboarding is not quite enough. We found a little, one of those carts you move furniture on. So then it was like, hey, ride the cart down. Of course, you got to bail out before you hit the wall. You know, there's a wall. And then, hey, let's put two guys on it. Okay. And it's like, hey, let's put three guys on it. It'll really go fast. I was the guy in the middle. So my next door neighbors, Robert and Peter Navarro. They one went this way, one then went that way, and I hit the wall. And had pinned the back of my right ankle between that cart and the wall. And a lot of blood and 30 stitches later, and my foot in a cast. I'm ready to start junior high school. Awesome. My first day, though, in the cafeteria. And I'm going through the line the very first day at school. And then I'm realizing as I get up there, it's like, how am I going to do this? And how am I going to, get a tray and all that stuff? And just about when I was realizing that maybe I'd just walk right on through and go out the other door, my friend came up to help me. But you have to know who my friend was. My friend was Lupe Rodriguez. Now, Lupe was a guy that had moved with his family from Mexico when we were in the fourth grade. Of course, he was probably supposed to be in about eighth grade, and that's the way they used to do it. It's like, no English? We'll just kind of move you back, And basically, we taught Lupe how to speak English. Probably not very well, but at least he could communicate. But he was older. He was a tough kid. I remember that movie, Happy Days Fonzie. Well, if you put a Mexican version on Fonzie, that's Lupe Rodriguez. He's the only kid in eighth grade that wore a motorcycle jacket, had the full hair thing, and had a mustache. How many kids have a mustache in eighth grade? I mean, we talk about the pecking order. Lupe is the toughest guy in the school, and there's no close second. And just as I was about ready to panic with my tray, Lupe Rodriguez, who I'd known since fourth grade, he comes up and he grabs my tray and he helps me through the line. And then first day of school, and then he sits down with me, helps me with my books and all my stuff, make sure I'm okay. Nobody mess with me. See, I can rewrite this verse in terms of death being the bully on the block. Oh, where, tough guys, is your victory? Oh, where is your sting? It is no longer has an effect on me because of Lupe Rodriguez. I was okay. That's what Jesus Christ does for death. There's no fear anymore. He's conquered it. It's not something we have to dread over, worry about. Because one day, if we place our faith in Jesus Christ, will receive an incredible resurrected body. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ, which I mentioned, is there's so much evidence for, and just volumes of books written over it, is the proof that we will receive a resurrected body. Again, Easter is a message of hope. It's a message of good news. And I just want to say also, just kind of in closing, it's a message that's really about families. And of course, this came to home once again just a few weeks ago when we traveled to California to do a memorial service for my niece's husband, who was only 41 years old, and died of basic toxic shock. They're still trying to figure out what happened. Guy was healthy as can be, and just a wonderful guy. We know. I mean, two little kids, leaves his wife and so forth. And she's doing awesome because she knows that she will be with him. She will see him. There's going to be a time gap. Maybe it's 4 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. We don't know. Whenever the Lord comes for us or she goes to be with the Lord, they'll be reunited again. It's not the same thing. That's why Paul says, we mourn and we weep, but not as other people weep, because it's a different issue for families when we come to faith in Jesus Christ. But as I shared at that service, I felt like I needed to kind of explain something to a lot of people, because he was a school teacher, a baseball coach. There was a lot of kids, a lot of former students. There was over 500 people, and I'm sure half of them, if not more, had maybe don't go to a church very often, don't have a relationship with the Lord. And I think it could have been a little confusing to say that Will, quote, got saved. Will was, quote, born again. Will had his sins forgiven. Because a lot of them were going, well, what sin would that be exactly? Because he was such a good guy. Again, I think he was more moral than most of the Christians I know. See, that bothers some people, that idea. But what needs to be understood is that It is not our morality that gets us into heaven. It is our faith in Jesus Christ. We have to be made fit for heaven by Jesus Christ. We cannot make it ourselves. Paul says in writing in 2 Corinthians, God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, he had no sin, to be sin for us, the sin offering, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. The issue is righteous. We get a resurrected body because Christ makes us righteous. And again, we live in a place here in Hawaii where we've got a real diversity, not only culturally, but certainly religiously. And I know people that are Buddhists, for example, that are very sincere about their faith and so forth. It doesn't matter what the religion is. The problem is none of those things can make you righteous. It doesn't matter how well you do it, how good you are at it. Sincerity doesn't help you. It's a matter of righteousness. Will was an awesome guy. I mean, such integrity, caring. I'll just give you an example. He's dating my niece, right? He's dating my niece. My mother's dying at the time. He would come over and spend 3.5 or 4 hours on a Saturday afternoon watching the Oakland A's, her favorite team, just to spend time with her. This is his girlfriend's grandmother. A lot of guys don't do that, but that's Will. So the idea, why does that guy need his sins for? Because everyone does. It's not a question of morality. Because I know I'm talking to some people here that are really good people and have lived really good lives. And they're very honest and they're hardworking. They care about their families and so forth. But this is a message for you as well. Again, if I go to OCCC, I don't have to convince anybody that they need the Jesus. They just need to know, is it possible still at this late date in my life? But the message is the same for all of us. God made him who had no sin to be our sin offering, so that in him, in Jesus, we are made righteous. We're fit for heaven, and we get this resurrected body. Again, how do I do that? I do that by placing my faith in Jesus Christ. Paul says in Romans 10:9-10, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For it is with the heart that you believe and are justified. It's with the mouth that you confess and are saved. So I just want to give you that opportunity if you haven't ever done that. If you want that resurrected body, if you want to know you'll be with the Lord for all eternity, what you need to do is confess with your mouth, believe in your heart. If you can believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and that Jesus is truly Lord, then you should just confess it through a prayer. And God will save you, God will forgive you, and God will give you that resurrected body one day for all eternity. But it's just not in the future, it's for now. Again, this is eternal life, that you may know the one true God and Jesus Christ, whom you need to have a relationship with him and know him. And that's the best part. We say the best thing about heaven is Jesus will be there. We're glad for all the other people as well, but it'll be awesome because he's there and we'll see him face to face, and it's going to be a glorious thing.
Breaking dawn, the rising shines on. And darkness tries to hide.